organics versus what you'll do, what you'll be able to do with Phoenix, and whether the region under the soil at the Viking sites had what the ice ratio was.
I'll take that question. I actually participated on Viking lander operations back in 1976. The deepest that we got was about 20 centimeters in a thing that we call deep hole, and that was fairly loose soil. There was no ice at the Viking Lander 1 site, which was just about 23 degrees north. We didn't find any ice in the soil at the Viking 2 site, which was 48 north, although we did during the winter. We survived during the winter season. A little bit of ice formed on the surface, but that was long after we had the capability to get the surface sampler arm out and to scoop up material. So we didn't actually sample any ice at either site. At Phoenix, we expect perhaps this much soil, maybe 5 inches or 6 inches. And every expectation from all the modeling that we've done, the gamma ray and the neutron spectrometer data from Odyssey, looking at the thermal wave through time with Mars Global Surveyor and Odyssey instruments, suggests that it's fairly loose soil, dry soil, over a very hard substrate of icy soil that's going to be as strong as the sidewalk outside because it's so cold.
You have a follow-up, Mark?
Thank you. I have a question for Peter Smith. And that goes really to sort of your motivation to shoulder this mission, especially after Polar Lander was lost in the cancellation. I think your colleagues have talked about the risk, but you must have seen some opportunity there. And I wonder what motivated you to kind of take this on?
Well, I'd experienced a wonderful success with Pathfinder in building the camera, and then the very disappointing failure with Polar Lander when we had no pictures returned from our cameras. But by gosh, we'd spent 15 years developing the hardware that had gone into the 01 and 03 missions, which weren't going to fly, and I really wanted some return from those. So I had to take on an entire mission to do so, but that's what I had to do, and that's what I'm going to do. And by God, we're going to get pictures. And we're going to learn something about these northern plains that I think will, in my greatest hope, is will change the direction of Mars exploration.
Okay, we are now going to go to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory with, I believe, one question and a follow-up. You are go, JPL. JPL, are you on?
JPL is here. Hi there. Pete Demetrio with KFWB Radio in Los Angeles. For Ray and for Peter, just a question, if you would. What's the threshold of water that you think you're hoping to find at this northern site, which could indicate there is life? Are we talking about damp soil? Are we talking about mud or something in between? And for Barry, a question related to the actual landing of Phoenix. Given what happens with the way Phoenix would land, are you going to be able to extrapolate information to this, which would lead to the landing of heavier spacecraft in that area or on the planet or even a manned spacecraft 10 or 15 years from now?
Let me start by saying there will be no liquid water found at the site when we get there because it is very cold right now. We are not on one of those climate cycles where there's a possibility of liquid water. So we would be tremendously surprised to find it at the temperatures that we see from orbit on the northern plains. However, in the past, when the climate was somewhat different, if that ice had melted, it would leave signatures in the soil. It would change the mineralogy. It would leave salt deposits. And it might even shape the grains in a way that we can understand with our instruments. And it's this past liquid water that we're looking for, as shown in the signatures in the soil. And Ray, you might want to add something to that.
There's a very simple test as to whether or not the pattern ground was formed in the presence of water that was ice and then melted. That is, in Alaska, when you have patterned ground and you dig through it and you look at the troughs, there are ice wedges in the center. So what happens is in the winter, it gets so cold and the ice is so strong, it can't maintain its integrity. As it gets colder and colder, it cracks. And the cracks open. And in the spring and the summer, when there's melt, water fills in the cracks. So you get these ice wedges. That doesn't happen in Antarctica in patterned ground because it never gets to the melting point of water. It's always too cold. Instead, the cracks get filled with dust and windblown sand. So if we're able to land in a place where we can excavate across a trough and into the polygon, and there's an ice wedge in the trough, it would indicate that there was some melt and the water moved to the crack and became an ice wedge. On the other hand, if it's just dust and sand in there, it would be more like an Antarctic process. That is a dry process where the ground just cracked in a very cold period and windblown material filled in.
Okay, and I'll answer the second half of your question, which is what will we learn from this lander for future missions? One of the key questions that I'm asked frequently relates to your question, which is why are we not using airbags? And the issue is that airbags have a fundamental limitation in terms of how much mass they can deliver to the planet. So one thing that we are demonstrating once again, although using slightly different technology, is the ability to use a more mass-efficient technology to land a vehicle on the surface of Mars. And so that's really the push forward that we're making here, and that will be followed by future landers using propulsive descent technology. Now, related to your question for man landing on Mars, I'm not qualified to address that. I don't have enough information to answer that question.
Okay, we are now going to head back to the East Coast and go to the Kennedy Space Center, where I believe we have a few questions. Kennedy Space Center, you are go with the question.
Hi, good morning. This is Craig Cavalt with Aviation Week with a couple of engineering and a couple of science. For Barry, I guess, can you discuss final assessments of atmospheric density going in relative to the parachute flexibility you may or may not have? And secondly, I don't want to start any rumors, but there's some at least scuttlebutt on the street that maybe you're taking looks at radar accidental lockup on the heat shield, which might cause you trouble. So those are my two, I guess, engineering questions.
Oh, let me answer those before you go to your science questions. I'll take them in reverse order. My memory is failing me. Let me talk about the heat shield. There, whatever rumor you're hearing is false. What probably spurred the rumor is during our testing of the system, we identified the possibility and reasonable likelihood, reasonable being in the 1-2% range from the perspectives that we take things from a reliability point of view, of the radar actually obtaining a false lock on the heat shield. This is one of the things that we found through our extensive simulation and test program. We actually made modifications, physical modifications of the radar itself, as well as modifications to the software to prevent that from happening. So you can correct that rumor. Forgive me, what was the other topic? Oh, atmospheric density. What we do is we continually, once a day, we get an atmospheric measurement that we actually receive from different teams. We get a measurement from the Mars MCS is Mars Climate Sounder. The Mars Climate Sounder on the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter gives us atmospheric information every day, and we actually do updates to what we call an engineering state file that determines that one of those parameters is what is the atmospheric density, and it varies the timing at which the chute is deployed to take that into account. And we can update that file as late as 3 hours before entry.
Craig, did you have some